Know that everything that you need to do what you are called to do and what you are meant to do in this world is already within you, and that you have the potential to lead and follow.
Welcome to Beyond the Ball Podcast.
What's going on, family? It's Jonathan Jones. Welcome to another episode of Beyond the Ball. And here we focus on sharing stories, strategies, and pulling tried and true strategies to help you successfully navigate through entrepreneurship. And I'm here today with my guest and my friend, Dr. Shauna T. Sobers. Dr. Sobers, how are you?
Oh, well, thank you.
That's good.
How about yourself?
I'm good. So
thanks
when you,
for having me.
So when you introduce yourself to people, how do you introduce yourself?
It depends on who it is.
Okay.
But lately it's been, hello, I'm Dr. Sobers.
Okay. You don't give no like credentials or nothing like that? Because I mean, I know, because depending on, I'm not sure if you've been to a networking event recently. I have not, because I don't like them. But I've always realized that at those type of events, you get the name, but then it's like, I've done this, I've done that, I've done this, I've done that. Do you ever, like, is that ever natural, or you just start with the name and then you see where the conversation goes?
Yeah, it depends on who I'm talking to, what the setting is, like what's going on, all of those things, but I tend not to share. But if I were going to share, I start with the TED Talk, because that's typically most notable. People, for the most part, know TED Talks, or I'll say something about being an author or number of years that I've worked in the field.
Okay.
Almost 20 now, so.
Wow. Okay, wait. Slow down. Wait a minute. Okay, so let's take us back. So what's the title of the TED Talk? And just give us like a high level of what you talk about in the TED Talk. I know, but for the people, like,
yeah,
you know, if they want to search it up, like what's the title of it and everything like that?
It's called Dance of Leadership.
Okay.
And at a high level, it is a mashup of Latin partner dance and leadership strategies that one could use anywhere. Partnership, any relationship, how do we take the tenets of partner dance and apply it?
Okay, and why was it dance that you chose? Right, or if this is, I don't think this is getting into your TED Talk, but like why dance and leadership, like I can see how it could work, but why this and why the infatuation with dance?
Yeah, so it came about because I am a dancer.
Okay.
So I think it helps when it's something that you're excited about, because then people feed off of your energy. But it came about because I would go to different dance lessons and they would be talking about how to do that particular move or how to lead it. And that instruction to me was like profound and universal.
Okay.
And I was just like, everyone needs to know this. Everyone can benefit from this. Anyone in any relationship can benefit. And so then I started a blog and called it Leadership Lessons from Dance.
Okay.
And I started blogging. And so whenever those moments would come up for me, I would just write about it. And people really seemed to resonate with it. And so then when UT Austin put a call out for their very first time doing a TEDx in 2018. I applied, even though it seemed like it was only for students, but I was like, I'm just gonna go for it.
Sure.
And so I went for it, I applied, but I didn't apply thinking about dance and leadership, actually.
Uh-huh.
I applied thinking about my resilience model theory based on my research. And then I recognized that part of the application was also recommendations. And so then I asked some of my grad students and some of my colleagues to recommend me for the TED Talk. And it was one of my grad students that actually, when she was recommending me, said, hey, she's a dancer, she has this blog, this is like, that's what they were excited about. And that's actually what they called me back for. And so I had put in this whole proposal for resilience, and then the, you know, organizers were just like, can you put in a proposal for this dance thing? Because that sounds exciting. And so at the last minute, I'm like, what am I going to put? Oh, well, I went back through my blog and pulled out the like four or five major things that people really resonated with, and that's how the TED Talk was actually created.
What's going on, family? I hope you're enjoying the episode. I had to interrupt it real quick just to let you know this, right? I know you're looking up and you're seeing the Eric Thomases and you're seeing the Inky Johnsons and the Donnie Wiggins and the David Shands all on these big stages. And you're like, how are they there? And why am I not up there? And the crazy thing is, the secret is this. They have the secret weapon which you haven't tapped into just yet. And that's a podcast, all right? So look, if you're in the DFW area, if you're an entrepreneur, you're a small business owner, you're saying, I want more eyes on my brand. I want to be able to monetize my voice. And I want to be compensated for sharing my wisdom and sharing my insight. Well, you need to be at my free podcast workshop this coming up weekend, all right? So go ahead, look, I'm not asking you for nothing except you giving me a couple of hours of that Saturday. Okay, so click the link just down below, go to startyourpodcasthere.com, and I'm gonna see you in the training because I'm gonna show you how we can cancel out those excuses and now level up to get you on the stage next. Back to the episode.
Wow. And I think that's really cool, just like from a high level view, like looking back, you've put out and documented like lessons from the past and things like that that you've experienced, and then you're able to go back, because sometimes, you know, the work that we do, especially because you have got the doctoral, the terminal degree, yeah, right, you've put in work, and I'm sure a lot of times you put your head down, there's papers that you've written and you forgot about, or you saved them over here, and yeah, and then when it comes time for you to reference something, you're able to go back and like, oh wow, I did do this. And yeah, and as I'm thinking about that, I just think so often we have accomplishments and we have things that we bury just based off of, okay, I got to keep working, I got to keep moving forward, I got to keep achieving and excelling. But I think that's really awesome. One, that you could have done a TEDx two different ways, honestly, probably about four different ways. Okay. But you know, going back and doing.
I hope to do another one.
Yeah, I mean, I think you will. But I wanna ask, what makes you so fascinated with leadership? Well, we'll go there. I got a different question, but we'll go there.
What makes me fascinated with leadership? Well, my doctorate is in education, administration, and leadership. Mm-hmm. So I did study leadership, but I think, okay, I'm gonna answer this about dance first.
Okay, yeah, talk to us.
So the reason why I think leadership was so interesting for me in dance is because I wasn't expected to be a leader on the dance floor. And so my belief is that everyone has the potential to be a leader, and that leading and following are both leadership. But they're roles that you play within a leadership model. So that, like, just in the way I think about things is different. And then when I went to learn how to lead as a dancer, and I began to challenge gender stereotypes and language, that just made it that much more profound for me and impactful. So that's on one end, but I think that also translates to me in leadership, is I often like being in spaces where I'm not expected to be, or I'm not expected to excel. And so I can remember, just even in undergrad, taking on jobs like the head tech crew supervisor for audio and lighting in the theater. So I started as an usher, and that's typical of women to do. Mm-hmm. And then I moved to the back of house and then became the supervisor for tech, and was one of few women who did that. And so I like challenging norms and stereotypes and doing things that people don't expect a person who looks like me or has my intersections of identities to do. And so as you begin to challenge those types of things, you get to recognize what sets you apart, and then you begin to recognize what makes you unique. And then the more I work to coach with people, or I really enjoy helping people learn how to supervise others. And so the more I learn how to help others, mm-hmm, then the more I'm unpacking what leadership is and how it can be, and think it really has helped also to work at a minority serving institution and work alongside Latina and Latinos and Latinx, because they come from a culture and a community that's very community-based and no one wants to be out front, but rather learning how to lead from the middle or learning how to lead from within is a concept that I was able to like share with them, is being a leader doesn't have to look one way just because that's what we've seen in the dominant culture, but knowing that you can lead from anywhere in the organization. You don't have to have the title. People say that all the time, but people don't often have the examples of what does that look like, how to do that, how do you tangibly make that happen. And so I was able to work alongside students as I advise student government and work with different leaders in different positions to get them to recognize the power that they had in who follows them, who's looking at them, who are they a role model for, and that they don't have to be in charge of the whole organization. They can be in charge of an event and still be considered a leader. So just those types of things are what led me to be fascinated by leadership, how to convey it, how to talk about it, how to embrace it.
What makes you qualified to teach leadership, right? And the reason I ask that is because we're in a time now, right, where anybody can be self-proclaimed as a guru. Anybody can. You don't need a degree to be a coach. You don't need a certificate to be a coach, even though some people are out here paying astronomical numbers to be certified and to get somebody else's stamp of approval to be a coach here, be a coach there. But what makes you qualified to teach on leadership or to talk on leadership, to be a thought leader on leadership?
I've been leading for over 20 years in different spaces, so I think my experience gives me qualifications. The testimonies of people who have been led by me is qualification. Because I think that's what speaks volume, is what impact have I had as a leader? Where are my receipts?
For and, sure, yeah, for sure.
And those are the things that make me qualified. But besides that, I do also have certifications. That speaks highly, though.
But go ahead, you can say.
I do also have certifications. Okay. And besides the master's in college student affairs and the doctorate in education administration and leadership, I am certified Gallup strengths coach. Mm-hmm. I am certified in strengths-based leadership for student success. I'm certified in intercultural competency, or intercultural conflict styles and intercultural development inventory. So some certifications. Okay.
Do you do consulting or coaching around that? Because I mean, you said with the strength yeah. base. You gotta help me out. I'm getting tongue tied.
Clifton Strength.
Yeah, there coaching. We go. Yeah. Yeah, there we go. Because I know with that, and I've even seen that when you understand a team, when you understand a team's objectives, mm-hmm. and then when you understand the strengths of the individuals that make the team,
yes.
it allows everybody to be so much more effective, efficient.
Absolutely.
And it helps the team flow so much better when you're aware.
It's an amplifier.
Yeah, when you're aware of, okay, in my toolbox I have a hammer, I have a drill, I have a wrench. They do not serve the same purpose. You can try to use the wrench as a hammer. I've done it before. It's not going to be as effective as the hammer.
Right.
And if I'm trying to make a hole, I don't want to use a hammer because it's gonna. Well, if I want to make a hole, I use a hammer. But if I use a drill, this will make a hole to where, you know, I can put something else in it, so it's more effective. And it can be secure, exactly. But if I use the hammer, then this is gonna be a hole.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm just trying to think, because I sat through one of your sessions when you broke down. Just walk us through, because the people out there don't know what the session was over and, you know, what was the purpose of the session? Talk a little bit about that. Yeah.
Okay, before I talk about that, though, mm-hmm. I will say that Clifton Strengths, and that's what the session was about, is really at its core positive psychology. And so it's really asking the question, what would happen if we focus on what's right with us rather than trying to fix what's wrong?
Say it again, Dr. Silver.
What would happen if we focused on what's right with us rather than trying to fix what's wrong? Because we live in a society that focuses on deficits. We focus on what's wrong, we focus on what's broken, we focus on what's missing, we focus on what we're not doing, what we don't have. And so we don't really have good language or a robust language for talking about what we're good at, what we like about ourselves, what we love about ourselves, what we do well, what we bring to the table. It's really hard for us to talk about that. And there's often a fear for us that if we do talk about it even a little bit, that would come across as being arrogant or being boastful or being, you know, full of yourself, where it's like, just a little bit, you know, or being able to acknowledge what you do well and being able to know it and then use that knowledge to help you strategize how to do it more and how to do it better and how to recognize where it can trip you up. You can overdo it or you can underdo it. The Clifton Strengths Assessment is one of many ways, which is why I was certified in strengths-based approaches for student success as well. So there's other tools. That's not the only tool, but it is a really good tool for thinking about what you're good at and what your characteristics are or what your how you perform. And then once you have that tool, then with a coach, everyone needs a coach.
This is true.
Everyone needs a coach. Coaches need coaches, right?
This is true.
And so once you have a coach that can help you put a mirror up and see yourself or help repeat back to you what you've said through that lens, or help you have activities or reflection or tools that you can use because you know yourself and it's in there. It's just about someone being able to pull it out of you and being able to give you the resources to level you up. And so that's the kind of work that I do. And then, so I have kind of three main specialties
I like to talk about. Take your time.
And so dance of leadership is one of them. And so I can certainly work with groups on just learning about leadership and just thinking differently about leadership and how they approach leadership. I like doing that with corporate places because usually they're having a lot of panels, a lot of speakers, and so this is a way to get into the body. And there's different ways that we learn things, and so moving our body and just having a break from, you know, the mind stimulation.
Disruption. Or it's disruptive.
A little bit. And so then just getting them to dance and get out of your box a little bit then helps them remember the lessons that I'm teaching in between the dance. And so that's kind of nice. So it's not only dance, it's dance, and there's also an educational component. So I really like doing that. I like doing strengths one-on-one coaching. And if I'm working with a team, and then a supervisor of the team, then that just like gives me goosebumps because then we can talk as a team about how do we understand one another, what we need from each other to be our best selves, how we can maybe judge others from what we know and how we do things rather than appreciate how someone's completely different. And so then that valuing others and appreciating others come when we begin to learn this tool and learn about ourselves. And then how do we create new pathways to do what we're already meant to be doing by using the talents that are already there? Both what we're meant to do and what we want to do are uniquely designed to be using the tools that you know were God-given. And so that's just like beautiful. So then I get to work. I like it when I work in a workshop and then do one-on-one and then do another workshop or do one-on-ones and then a workshop. But I like that combination. And so that's like kind of my second realm of working with folks or consulting. And then the third piece is resilience. And so being able to sustain in an environment where people like yourself or in your identities don't typically sustain. So my research was specifically on Black women who were in executive leadership positions at predominantly white institutions and gaining from them the strategies that they used to get where they are and then stay where they were for over 10 years in their in that role, reporting directly to the president of the university. And so then I took that knowledge and information and eventually over time of working with doing a lot of workshops and doing pre-conferences and institutes. And this is my 5-year anniversary of hosting a monthly gathering of Black women at UT. And so from all of those conversations, creating a model that anyone can use to build their resilience in anything that's coming at them. And so, but the overarching is positive psychology. What's right with you in leadership, in supervision or how you're looking at yourself and how you're using that to navigate, and in your resilience, the thread is positive psychology, looking at what's right.
Why do you think it's so hard for us not to focus on what's right, but focusing on, I got a 94, but I didn't get these 6, and now I'm upset about these 6, or, why do you think that is?
We're socialized that way. We get rewarded for putting ourselves down or for focusing on what we did wrong. Like, we bring home the report card and we got, a C, 2 B's and an A. The first thing someone's gonna comment on is what? The C. The C gets the most attention. But this philosophy flips that. It doesn't say to ignore those things. It says to pay most attention on the area of strength. So hey, you got that A, there's clues there, there's gems there that we're leaving on the table. Why did you get that A? What was it about that teacher, the way they taught? What was it about the subject? Like, what were the strategies you used to study? Like, how did you stay interested? And then how do we do that same thing in these other subjects that you didn't do so well in? How do we find a teacher who does that or a tutor who does that? How do we, use those same study habits that you used over here? How do we combine this so that we can manage the weakness and then leave it there and be like, okay, it's good enough where it is, because that's not where my area of strength is. That's not where my, investment is gonna exponentially grow. This is. So I'm gonna spend most of my time here. I'm gonna do this to the point where it doesn't impede my growth, but then I'm going to leave that. If that's a B and that's where it lies, that's it. And then I'm going to spend most of my time in this place where there is an A, because I can get A pluses there, or I can, start leading others there. I can start, creating a following there.
So I usually ask this toward the end, but I'm just going to ask it now. What's something that you want people to know that people either typically don't ask you? Yeah, that's it, we'll stop right there. What's something you want people to know that nobody has asked you, or people typically just don't ask you, but you want the people to know this about you or about your work or whatever?
That's a really good question. What is something that people don't typically ask me that I want people to know? People ask me a lot of stuff. What I've found myself talking about more is that I think we started talking about it a little bit, is that I am an introvert.
Okay.
And I think that's fascinating, and I would want people to know that about me, because I think some people hold themselves back from getting in certain arenas because they think that there's only one way to do it. And for me, I cannot believe that I do the things that I do. But it comes from the place of my strengths and what I'm passionate about. And then that gives me the fuel to then like go out there and speak about it. But if you put me in a room with a whole bunch of people, I'm probably gonna observe and not speak and not shine for a little bit until I warm up and, you know, begin to be introduced to people or feel comfortable. Then I let loose, and then people are like, "Where was all of that this whole time?" But I am an introvert, and when I say that, often people are like, "That's wrong. Like, if I don't know myself, or like, I don't believe you," because I'm able to speak or present or have energy and enthusiasm. And so the piece of it that I think is important for people to know is that when I talk about introvert, extrovert, I'm thinking about and talking about where do I get energy, not what I can and can't do. So I'm competent, I can do things, but I still identify as an introvert because I get energy from being in reflection, being in my mind. And one of my Clifton strengths is intellection, and that's like liking to muse or philosophize or, you know, think through things and process. And so that's where I get my energy, that's where I recharge, that's where I get my fuel. And then, because I've done that work, then I can come out and speak about it and talk about it and share with others what I've been thinking. And then their thoughts and their feedback then feeds me so that I can keep doing it more. But it's not about, oh, you can't, you know, get up and speak and have energy. It's more about, after that, I'm exhausted and then I need to go plug in again, like we do with our phones.
For sure, yeah, I get that. Have you ever been in a room and you've been sitting back, taking it in, and then you, let me rephrase it, have you ever missed out on an opportunity in a room because you sat back too long and you were just your introverted state?
Yes, I'm sure I have. I think I did that a lot as a child and as a young professional. And so then I think that experience helps me to now speak up a little bit quicker when I'm in a room and I have something to say, or I feel like my voice or my perspective or my experience could be contributing or could be insightful and useful, then I'll speak up a lot quicker than I used to. And then, of course, I'll have, as Brené Brown talks about, then I'll have vulnerability hangover, and then I'll go and like process and think about all the things that I said and be like, oh, do I regret this? I don't know. Like, is it bad?
Vulnerability hangover.
It definitely feels like a crash. It feels like, oh no, like a sickness of like, did I speak too much? Did I share too much? Yeah, like all of those questions. And so I do go through that as well, but most of the time people are very thankful that I did speak up, and I check in with people like, is that too much? And they're like, oh my goodness, no. So.
Well, that's good.
It's good.
That's good. I mean, that's good to even have people to check in with, like, you know,
for sure.
To be able to
stop the
self-doubt. Yeah, console, and I mean, cut that off too, like cutting off the self-doubt, because it's tricky that if we stay in our mind too long, like, because you talk about musing and, what did you say, intellectualizing, say it?
Introspective?
Well, no, you used a different word.
Or intellection is the...
Yeah, so just, you know, just being in the state of intellection too long.
Right, then, I mean, there's a shadow side to that.
I was about to say, talk about that.
Every strength has a shadow side. It has something where, okay, so... This is the quote that I'll often share, is every leader will make their biggest mistakes in their area of strength. Mm. Every leader will make their biggest mistake in their area of strength because it's what you do naturally. You don't have to think about it. You're gonna do this thing. It's a natural reoccurring pattern of your thoughts, feelings, and behaviors is a talent. And so when you become a leader, that can become a crutch because it's like, hey, what got me here, I'm gonna keep doing. Rather, it becomes a blinder sometimes. And then we're just focused on, this is the way we do it, this is the way I've gotten here. That happens a lot for supervisors. They become a supervisor because they did good work, and so now they think to be a good supervisor, they gotta get everyone else to do it the way they did it. And it's not acknowledging that there's other ways to get there, and there's other ways to support, and there's other ways to scale things. And so when you become a leader, yes, do the things that are in your strength, but also have around you the advisory board of people who can tell you the truth, because the higher up you go, the less people feel comfortable telling you about yourself or telling you what they're actually thinking. And so you have to be able to create a culture of people that you can check in with, like, tell me for real, like, how is this going, how is this doing, what am I missing, what am I forgetting, and continue to be mentored by others so that then you can continue to use your talents without it tripping you up and causing you to fall flat on your face. You want to fall forward, not fall flat.
Gotcha. All right, so we're gonna take a slight pivot, okay? And we're gonna lighten up a little bit. This segment called This or That, where you choose like one or the other. What do you say? Oh dear.
I don't know. We'll see.
Oh my goodness. Okay, you're gonna choose one or the other. Are you ready?
Nope, but we're doing it anyway.
Okay. Winters or summer?
Summer.
Okay. Big get together, small gathering?
Small.
Pancakes or waffles?
Pancakes.
You look like you didn't want to say either.
Neither.
I said you look like you didn't want to say either.
No.
Okay.
But pancakes.
Okay. Yeah. Chick-fil-A or Raising Cane's?
Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A or Popeyes?
Popeyes.
Audiobooks or podcasts?
Audiobooks?
Okay. Give me your top three. Give me your top three books. I just want to hear this. This one has to be leadership books. These are your top three books like you would recommend to somebody.
It depends on who it is.
Of course.
But I do enjoy the Dresden Files. It's a sci-fi series.
Okay.
About a private investigator in a fairy tale world. Okay. Or like a cross between Chicago and the Never Never or the fairy tale world.
Okay.
So he's solving, you know, problems that are in our world but caused by fairy tale creatures.
It's good. Okay.
And it's Jim Butcher, and they're on book like 23.
Sheesh.
And so I really enjoy that you get to stay with those characters and you get to, you know, delve into new different ways of thinking about supernatural beings. So that one.
Okay. Do you think supernatural beings are real? Like, is that a real thing?
It could be.
When you say supernatural, what does that mean?
Oh, there's so many different, well, in the books at least, there's like werewolves, and then he'll go through different types of werewolves.
Okay, okay.
And then, or like, you know, vampires, or like,
gotcha.
You know, necromancy, they'll go through, you know, different, he explores a lot of things. Fairies, trolls, yeah.
Okay. I'm just kidding.
So it could be.
Okay.
Maybe.
Okay. Now I just want to give you a chance to, this is what I like to call this the winner circle of the week, right?
Okay.
And I just like to give people an opportunity to shout out somebody or give somebody flowers to somebody who you've seen work, be diligent in their space, their industry, wherever it might be, whatever it might be, but they may feel unseen or overlooked or whatever that might be. Who was that person or persons for you?
Man, wow. I think Dr. Mylon Kirksey.
Okay.
Right, do you recognize that name?
I don't think so, but keep going.
That's why he deserves the flowers, because he's done so many things and just is such an amazing leader and has helped so many different leaders, and yet is not really like well known yet.
Okay.
But he is, in particular, I think he's really great at the, and he's the reason why I'm certified in intercultural development inventory. So he's really great in organizational governance and design and consulting on how do you understand organizational change through this lens of intercultural competency. This really powerful stuff. But he's the impetus for the Longhorns for a Culturally Competent Campus that we have on campus.
Okay.
Or what we call LC3. And so it's a class, or it's no credit. So students volunteer to come be a part of this, and it's 10 weeks. And they come in, and we have a bunch of instructors that are part of it, because whoever's in that class or that cohort also gets coaching one-on-one. Mm-hmm. So they take this inventory pre and post. We go through the lessons of privilege and power and socialization, the cycles of socialization or conflict styles, or all of these different topics.
Mm-hmm.
And we spend, you know, 20 to 30% of the class time just explaining the topic, but the 70 or 80% in dialogue. So they have to learn how to talk about these topics and talk with one another about these topics and learn how to give feedback. And then you go off with your coach and you talk about where your development is and how you made sense of what happened in that classroom space and how you engage with other people around those topics and how it was influenced by your mindset of how you see how to communicate around culture. And then you come back the next week and you continue to build. And so he's really the impetus for that at Georgia State, and then as well as University of Texas.
Wow.
And yeah, and it just, and he's also like a faculty in, with the in intercultural development inventory space, and he'll go around consulting. And so many universities probably know his work and have felt the impact of his consulting without it being like really widespread.
That's good.
He's actually the reason why I'm in Texas now.
Wow, okay.
He's a supervisor I followed. He said, this is a good space for you. And I was like, I believe it, I trust it, and I know that you wouldn't recommend something that wouldn't be, and it has been such a great move for me.
Nice. Well, now I want you just to tell everybody where they can find you, follow you, connect with you, all that good stuff at this time.
Absolutely. Hi, everybody. So you can find me on Instagram, on Twitter, on LinkedIn, all with Shauna T. Sobers as the handle, and also as my website, shaunatsobers.com. So that's how to find me.
There we go. And you have a final word that you want to leave with the people? Just, I don't know, anything on your heart you just want to share?
I would say, know that everything that you need to do what you are called to do and what you are meant to do in this world is already within you, and that you have the potential to lead and follow. Mahalo.
There it is. Can't say it any better than that. If you enjoyed our conversation today and you want to find more content like it, be sure to subscribe on our YouTube channel. You can type in Beyond the Ball Media on YouTube. And if you listen to the audio version of this podcast, be sure to follow the podcast Beyond the Ball with Jonathan Jones. Until next time, family, I'm Jonathan Jones, and we're out.
How do you feel?
Great.
Yeah, you said you do well in interviews.